Very good afternoon. Thank you, Sujit. I'm going to talk about the direct taxes. And as you very rightly said, that tax is always very taxing for people. So it's important to just share what's all happening, especially in India. And just going to cover up, if you'll see the contents, in terms of that, I'm going to cover the overview of the key international developments which are taking place, strengthening the tax information exchange across, revaluation of the, in the Mauritius route, bolstering the source-based taxation, because Indian taxes are purely based on the source base, development in the transfer pricing, which has been the pains, especially for those who have been doing the business in India, and then introduction of GAR. In terms of the key international development, it's not that something which India is very aggressive on the tax side. Just to share with you in terms of G20 endorsement, if you look at it, they have G20 finance ministers took a call, and it's not only the developing countries, but including developed countries, they all thought it is important to look into the base erosion and profit shifting action plan. And as you know, that they have already come out with the action plan, and they intend to implement the same by 2014 and 15. And they have picked up 14 action points, mainly, you know, trying to cover up addressing concerns with respect of digital economy. As you know, that now the digital economy is effectively across, and now people, you can place an order here to buy anything from New York, and now there are issues on direct and indirect in terms of how to tax such transactions. Establishing international coherence and corporate income taxation, that's something you have been seeing, that there has been a hybrid mismatch, that for the same expense you need, the companies are effectively claiming two deductions, or under the double taxation treaty, you're not paying taxes. You have structured the transaction in a way that you're not paying taxes in any country. Restore the full effects and the benefits of international standards. Assure that the transfer pricing outcomes are in line, and there should be a value creation and risk. Ensure the transparency. I think that's something which is very important, so that one can promote increased certainty and stability. And especially as you would have seen, especially in the case of Vodafone, where internationally it was not taken very effectively the way the government, after receiving the Supreme Court order, brought in the amendment which was retrospective. Countering the harmful tax practices and treaty abuse, we know that yes, the way that the transactions are structured without having any substance in the country, people are trying to avail that the treaty, you know, the benefits. Developing controlled foreign corporation, which is known as CFC rules, where you have a concept of consolidating everything at a holding company level. So I think these are some of the important initiatives which G20 have taken a call. Now, only thing which would need to be seen is that when all the 20 companies would like to achieve this, I think there is a need also to make appropriate amendments at the domestic level. Unless you will not be able to align the same, it would be very difficult to achieve the same. And if you look at it, it's not only G20, which includes all the developed countries like USA and UK. Even the at European level, if you will see that the European Commission proposal to extend its directives on an automatic exchange of information to cover the dividends, capital gains, account balance. Effectively in Europe, you know, if you travel by road or by train, just in an hour's time, you can cross the country, and people structure their transactions in a manner that they don't pay taxes. So now even they also got a little careful in terms of ensuring that wherever there are some loopholes, they are required to be plugged in. European Parliament proposal to oblige all multinational companies to publish single figure amount of tax paid each member state in which they operate. As you have been seeing that, especially in the case of Amazon, Google's, etc., or even the, you know, the Microsoft, the way they have structured their transactions, they said maybe they're not paying taxes, sufficient taxes, or not paying taxes in a way, the way they have structured in any country. So I think that's what has become like an, you know, eye-opener for the countries to look at. Similarly, if you look at it, it's not only the developing countries, or maybe it's G20, even G8, all the developed countries also come up with a log earned declaration on exchange of information in order to fight the scourge of tax evasion. Further, if you look at it, China also, as you know, people have been having the big base in China. They are sending their people on secondment. They have just recently, a few months back, come out that the people who are sent on secondment, there needs to be, there are certain guidelines which they have come out with, so that in terms of not having a permanent establishment by sending your people in such a manner would not really be possible unless you will not comply with those guidelines. Because they believe that there has been an evasion. People are being sent on these secondments and they are still projecting as if it is not a presence of a host country. Australian government is imposing a 10% non-final withholding tax on certain taxable Australian property by the foreign tax residents. So they would like to see if, you know, either you are earning a rental income or at the time when you sell, they wanted to ensure non-final withholding of 10% so that they can look at the transaction and then see the final taxability on this. Similarly, on the Argentine's new definition of the tax haven, where they are saying there is a zero or a nil taxation, you need to have an exchange of information. Canada imposes new offshore property and income reporting requirements. Same has already been introduced in India, that if anyone who is a resident in Canada, they need to disclose all their foreign tax holdings. And especially mainly United States of Foreign Account, you know, the Tax Compliance Act, which has insisted all the banks, insurance companies, even the mutual funds companies, to give information to the revenue authorities for all the American citizens whose accounts worth more than 50,000 lying offshore. So I think that's something which has also become very, you know, the taxing for just for the bankers and even the insurance companies. So if you look at it across globally, whether it is developing country, Asia, Europe or US, across, I think all the governments are very much focusing in terms of ensuring that the erosion of tax base, the way people are shifting their profits, it needs to be curtailed. Coming into this, so therefore, through this slide, I'm trying to show whether it is G20 or G8 or OECD, they all are trying to find ways how one can counter the, you know, the tax avoidance and evasion. In terms of strengthening the tax information, especially on Indian side, would just like to share that the, you know, in terms of what has already been spelled out in BEPS, which I shared for G20 companies, India already brought in a law 2 years back to say that the government has a right to notify any jurisdiction where they find that they, without any substance, people are trying to avoid paying taxes. They can declare any jurisdiction. And few days back, Cyprus has already been declared as a notified jurisdiction under Section 94 of A of Income Tax, where they very clearly spelled out that. And this is the first jurisdiction, and that's why you have been reading in the papers that Cyprus authorities are a little upset on that, because there's a huge investment which has already been come to India through Cyprus. An interesting thing what they're saying is any transaction you have with the Cyprus, it would have to go through a transfer pricing, the arrangement of arm's length, whether it is a related party or not. Similarly, any expenditure which you are incurring in Cyprus or in relation to Cyprus would not be allowed unless the details would not be examined. Similarly, any income which you receive from Cyprus would be subject to tax at the rate of 30% blindly, and appropriate taxes or refunds would be given after examining all the details in the documentation. India has also signed, a tax information exchange agreement with Bermudas, Bahamas, Cayman Islands, and so many other tax havens, so-called. So therefore, all those who have been placing either through trust at these locations would also be subject to very detailed scrutiny by the tax authorities. Double taxation avoidance agreement with Singapore, with Switzerland, with Australia, with UK, with UAE, and especially with Sweden, where they are saying that a lot of information, it can be exchanged. Like people, those who have to pay taxes in India, and if they have their properties lying, say, in UK, even the tax authorities can, with the support of UK authorities, can sell those properties to recover the taxes. So primarily they are focusing on enhanced exchange of information clause, assistance in collecting the taxes if the monies are lying abroad, and tax examination. Even the tax authorities in India, especially with UK, they sign with the support of the government, and it is the part of the treaty that if a person who's also a resident in India, and if the tax authorities wants to get any details or wanted to examine anything relating to that individual, the information which is there in UK, they can also collect the same in terms of completing the investigation in India. So in a way, government, I think, is working very hard in terms of ensuring that strengthening the tax information exchange so that appropriate investigation could be done. On the Mauritius route, as you all know, there's a lot of investment which has already come through Mauritius. Now, the government has already introduced the concept of TRC, which is a tax residence certificates. You need to get it in order to get any benefit under the treaty. The budget of Mauritius of 2014, a week back, they introduced also and they reaffirmed the adherence to the multilateral convention on the mutual administration assistance in all the tax matters developed jointly by the Council of Europe and OECD. And interestingly, they have come out with all the offshore companies who have their presence in Mauritius in order to give them a tax residence certificate. Now they have also come out with the guidelines that certain parameters are required to be seen before the TRS would be given. And they said that one of the following parameters needs to be satisfied before the tax residence certificate to any company which is based out of Mauritius is there would have to be achieved. So they are saying that office premises should be available in Mauritius. Mauritius resident employees should be employed in full-time basis. The constitution should contain a clause whereby all the dispute arising out of the constitution shall be resolved by the arbitration in Mauritius. The company should have Mauritius-based assets of at least $100,000. The shares of the company are listed on the security exchange licensed by the Mauritius Financial Services Commission. The yearly expenditure of the company in Mauritius should be the same level as similar corporation which is controlled and managed from the Mauritius. And we have been hearing it that the government is also trying to negotiate the treaty with India, especially with Mauritius, and they are thinking of introducing LOB, and the discussions are on for so many years, where, as you are aware, that anyone who's coming through Mauritius, if they sell the shares of a Mauritian company under the treaty, they are not taxed. The long-term capital gains or the capital gains are not taxed in India. And they said that it would be taxed only in Mauritius. And effectively, in Mauritius, you don't have, under the laws, domestic laws, the capital gains are exempt. So in a way, people are trying to route their transactions. And that's why government is trying to see how they can plug those loopholes. So effectively, India is, as you are aware, is basically focusing on the source base. So indirect transfers, there was always an ambiguity. And now Vodafone, you are aware of that. There was a sale of shares by one non-resident to another non-resident, not direct investment. Even the law has been amended retrospectively to say all the indirect tax, all the indirect transfers would also come into the ambit of taxation in India. Royalties and fee for technical services now under the domestic law, it has been increased to 25%, which is the highest in the world. And place of utilization of services and redemption of services has become a determinative. Not only, so that's very different. And then dilution of difference between copyright and copyrighted article. Even now there are judgments to say you are buying a software which is like a copyright, like buying a book, which is a copyrighted article, still is considered as a copyright to be taxed as a royalty. Because, and then lastly, on the P and the transfer pricing issues, if you see that the subsidies are treaties as permanent establishment in the country, location saving transfer adjustments or advertising marketing promotion, which is AMP, expenses are also captured in transfer pricing adjustments. So if you look at it across, the intention is that if you are sourcing any income out of the country, you will have to pay the taxes in one way or another. So I think that's where the government is now reaffirming the concept of source base. Coming on, you would have read about the Shell, where the Shell parent company subscribed the shares of an Indian company at a value X. And the officers come back and said, instead of subscribing at rupees 10, the value should have been not X, but it should be Y. And the difference was treated as a loan given by the Indian subsidiary to the parent company, which was very strange. And they said Indian company should have also earned the interest on top of that. So those kinds of adjustments have already been confirmed. Certainly the matter is pending in the courts. But such is the one which was debated globally. So that kind of adjustments are there. Similarly, the marketing expenses, as you are aware, that all the advertising, marketing and promotion was done, say, by LG. And now the tax authorities are coming back and saying that if you are incurring higher expenses, the more than the benchmarking which they have determined, would be disallowed as you are spending this money for the parent. So in a way, those adjustments have also been done, and which have already been confirmed by the tribunal, and the matters are pending in High Court. To that extent, if people, foreign companies are using Indian base, if they are using as India as a, probably as a locational saving because the labor cost is much cheaper here, they are subcontracting the contracts to India. Even the tax authorities are saying what foreign companies are paying because of the location saving, they need to pay taxes which they are earning abroad. A part of it should also be in India. And so such kinds of location saving, AMP, or even on subscription, I think the tax authorities are trying to capture such transactions and trying to pay taxes on that. Coming on the transfer pricing, just to share that now APA, advanced pricing, the mechanism has already been introduced in India, where you can have a unilateral, bilateral, or multilateral. And interestingly, the government has also come out with a safe harbor rules, where they are saying that if you are in a particular, the business, then if you accept, say, 20% or 25% of profits allocated or attributed to India, you don't need to do anything more than that. So that is a safe harbor rule. There are certain challenges which have just been introduced a few months back, that in spite of your following the safe harbor rules, you need to maintain all your documentation. And those who do not go for safe harbor rules, they are worried that whether the tax authority would imply the same rates, higher profit, which is there in safe harbor rules, on those companies who have not opted for safe harbor rules. So I think these are the things which, as far as the transfer pricing is concerned, is happening. In terms of the last, I just wanted to share the GAR, I think journal entry avoidance rules, which has already been introduced, but effectively it would become effective in India from the tax year 2015 and 16, where they are saying that the primary condition is the main purpose of the arrangement is to obtain any tax benefit. And if you satisfy any of the conditions like creates rights and obligations.